everybody, welcome back to my channel. My name is Crystal and this is my social thread. Welcome back to all my regular viewers. Thank you for coming back to watch me again, to hear me babble on about sewing. And to those of you that are new here, this is my sewing channel, as I've said, where I talk about all my sewing makes for myself and for my children. I talk sewing patterns, fabrics, that sort of thing. So if that's something that you might be interested in, please do subscribe. And if you are enjoying my content, please do click the like button as well. And please share with your friends. Thank you so much. So today is my plans video, plans for February. I've not done a plans video for a while because I've just been busy. I think I've not done one since I had my baby in April, baby number 9 in April 2023, and he's 9 months old now, baby Theo, the cutest thing. I'll pop up a photo of him, actually. He's very cute. And he is just taking up some of my time, almost of my time. But I do have some plans for you. And the reason I'm making a plans video is also to get some advice onto which on which pattern I should make for one of my plans. So my first plan is to use up my stash. I have been in the past couple of months using up my stash for children's makes where they're remnants of things, but also just generally trying to get my stash down because I have a lot of fabric, as most of us do, and I really don't want to start buying or just buy anything really just for the sake of it. I am trying to buy per project, which at the moment I'm not buying at all because I do have fabric that I need to get through. Anyway, what I've decided to do is my daughter Anya, who is 9 years old, has requested some winter dresses because she would just like some winter dresses. And so my go-to pattern for girls' dresses is the Be Curious dress by Ellie and Mac, which I've made many times before. And this is a great versatile pattern because depending on the fabric that you choose, it's really a seasonal, an all seasons type of pattern. So it's this one here, Be Curious. It goes from 12 months to Big Kid 12. Although my daughter is 9, I have just made, I think I'm going to cut out the age 12 for her according to her measurements. The waist is going to be a bit bigger, so I might taper that in, but everything else is spot on. So I think I'm going to go for the age 12 for her. But usually, actually, with my children, they are taller than, I guess, the average of where how these patterns are drafted, so I'm going to go for that. So it's basically a very simple dress. It's just got a bodice, long sleeves or short sleeves and a ruffle, and it's got a ruffle at the bottom here, and it's just got buttons at the back, and elasticated cuffs here. And this is sort of a vintage style where the bodice is quite short. I normally lengthen mine anyway. I like the long sleeves and I like the ruffle as well, so I'm just going to lengthen everything a little bit so it's below the knee. Very simple instructions, and all colored instructions as well, so very easy to use. As I say, I've probably made this about 5 or 6 times in the past. And the fabric that I'm going to use, again, these are remnants from me. Well, one of them is a remnant from myself. Actually, tell a lie, it's not a remnant. I bought this in the Lady McElroy sale 2 years ago now, and it's a lovely, let me just show you. Well, I'll say lovely. It's a lovely viscose linen from Lady McElroy. It's a black base with like lots of florals. Now, when I got the fabric, when I saw the fabric online, I really, really liked it. But then when it arrived, I didn't like it. I just think it was just a bit, I don't know. It's just, I'm not sure. It just wasn't me. Like from far away, it looks nice, I think. But up close, it just wasn't me. I just wasn't happy with it. And I have bought 2 meters in their remnant sale. And it's been in my stash, as I say, for 2 years now. Anyway, I didn't force it on my daughter. I did ask Anya, although I had to ask several times, Anya, do you like this fabric? Do you like it? Do you like it? She said, yes, mummy, she does. I do. And so I am going to make her this dress in that. So that's my first dress that I would like to make. First fabric that I'd like to make the Be Curious in. The second fabric is already cut out. It's some needle cord, printed needle cord from Pound Fabrics in a wine colour. And I didn't have enough for the lining, so I've cut that all out already, and I didn't have enough for the lining, so I've just used some leftover fabric that I used for a coat project of mine a while ago. I mean, it doesn't match at all, but the colours are very similar and you won't see it anyway. It's just to line the front and the back bodice. So that's the second version I want to make, Anya. And lo and behold, I have that fabric in another colourway, in the navy colourway. So exactly the same in the navy colourway, exactly the same dress. And hopefully those three dresses will keep her going for the next couple of months in terms of for like Sunday mass or if we're going to somebody's house, something like that. So that's what I plan to do with those. And I've kept my plans quite simple because my next project that I want to do that I'm going to show you now is quite a big chunky project. It's a coat. And basically, I have made two coats in the past. I'll pop up a picture of the first coat. This is a McCall's pattern. And the fabric is a really, really nice purple herringbone tweed from Rainbow Fabrics. I think it's Deadstock. Can I say Deadstock Ted Baker? I'm not sure. But it's really, really beautiful. And I made this coat. And what I did, what I don't like about it is the bottom of the coat where the lining meets the hem of the coat. I sewed it down. And I know you're not supposed to do that. You're supposed to hand stitch it. And I sewed it down and you can see the stitches and it's kind of bagging out and it just looks really, really awful. Now, my plan is to unpick it, but because of the nature of the wool, you can't really tell the difference. You can't really see the stitching. So it's very, very difficult to see what you're actually trying to unpick. And so that's been sat in my wardrobe for a year and a half maybe now. So that's a shame. But also that particular style of coat where the shawl collar is quite surely, it kind of reminds me a bit of a bathrobe. And so, and also there's got big patch pockets, square patch pockets. So it's very bathrobe-esque. And so it just wasn't for me. And then the second coat that I've made is this coat here. It's the Heather Blazer from Closet Core Patterns, I believe. Yes. And I just basically extended it to make it into a coat. So now this is really lovely. But what I don't like necessarily is the sleeve head kind of, there's drag lines in the sleeve head. And so, I mean, there is no shoulder pads or anything in the Heather Blazer because it's supposed to be like a really easy version, like a easy version of a jacket without all the tailoring skills that you would normally put into a jacket or a coat. So there's no shoulder pads, so maybe that's the reason. And also the back vent, I kind of made up myself. I did use a tutorial, but believe it or not, the back vent, it looks like a simple thing, but it's actually really difficult in my opinion anyway, especially attaching the lining to the back vent without it pulling and just sitting right. It was very, very difficult. So I don't wear that one either. Luckily enough, the Heather Blazer one my daughter wears, so that's great. And then I have a couple of other smart coats that I wear. I've got quite a few casual coats, but that's, you know, I was after like a smart coat. But now my daughter Sienna wears my beige smart coat ready to wear, and then my daughter Talia wears my Heather Blazer navy one. So I don't really have a coat. Actually, I do have a coat, that's a lie. I have a burgundy, I think it's from New Look coat that I wear, but the fabric is all bobbly and it's just not very nice. And I just don't feel really, I just feel really scruffy in it. So anyway, I want to get a new coat. All of that basically boils down to the fact that I would like to make a coat for myself. And so now I have really, really gorgeous fabric. And again, I bought this fabric years ago, probably about 5 years ago now, and I bought 6 meters. And the reason I bought 6 meters was originally I had my eye on a Vogue pattern. If I can find it, I'll pop up a picture up here. And it's a Vogue, a vintage pattern, Vogue. And it was sort of like a fitted bodice with a collar, with a lapel, long sleeves. And it was a full circle skirt of the coat, basically. So it's like a dress coat. And it required 6 meters of wool. And I don't know what you know, you do, but sometimes I don't know if you ever have these ideas where you're going to buy the fabric, buy the pattern, buy all the notions, but never ever make the pattern. So I think I've had everything for this particular pattern for like, so I had the fabric for about four or five years. I've had everything ready for this pattern. But I don't ever want to make it because now I've realized that I don't really use the big four patterns because I don't find the instructions very thorough, especially with a coat where I would need and I would want proper instructions, proper illustrations, video tutorials if they're available, and to create a pattern, because it's just a lot more detail, and there's a lot more expense as well that goes into a pattern, which I'm sure you all understand. And so I've had this fabric for a while, and it actually was delivered to me on a roll, like a big, huge roll. And when we moved from London to where we are now in Cambridgeshire, it was still on this big, massive roll, and I've had to fold it over. So it's sort of bent like this. In the end, when I was moving my sewing room from the upstairs bedroom to the downstairs bedroom, this office sewing room now, I unrolled it off the roll, and I've just folded it in half. And it was only yesterday that I decided to pre-treat my wool, because if I don't do that, I'm never going to get anything started with this wool. And so it's 6 meters. I cut it in half, basically. So I've got 3 meters, 3 meters. And how I treat my wool is, there's several ways to treat wool. And I learned this from Tomcat Stitchery. Is her name Whitney? I was going to say her name was Cat, but that's not Tomcat Stitchery. And her name is Whitney. Very good YouTube YouTuber. She's Instagram. I think she sews full time. I think she has like 30,000 followers on YouTube. You know, so she's really, it's her full time job. Anyway, she has some tips on how to treat wool, pre-treat wool. One option is to take it to your dry cleaners, and apparently they pre-shrink it for you. I don't know if they have that option here in England, but I've never tried to do that. Another option is to lay your fabric out like on the floor, and then I think you put dry soaking wet towels on them, and then you let the wool absorb it, and then you hang it out to dry, something like that. And then the third option was the easiest option, which is the option I obviously went for, is you put your fabric in the tumble dryer with a large towel that's soaked in water. And when I say soaked, it's saturated in water, but it's not necessarily dripping. Maybe it's dripping a tiny bit, but it's not like dripping, but it's fully saturated, full of water. And you put that large towel with your wool in the dryer, and you press the dryer button. And then once the towel is dry, your wool has pre-shrunk. So now I did mine, and I have a setting that's called extra dry, and that's about 2 hours and 20 in the dryer. And I put it in, and when I took it out, the towel was still a bit damp, so I put it in for another one, and then another one. So I ended up doing 6 hours in the dryer. Luckily, we have solar panels on our property, so during the day all our electricity is free, which is great. So basically it was 6 hours in the dryer with this towel, and eventually the towel came out dry. And I measured the fabric. So before I put it in, it was 6 meters long. So chopped that down into 3 meters, and then it was 150 wide. And when I took it out, it didn't even shrink at all. I mean, if it did, it by millimeters. So there was no shrinkage whatsoever. And so I measured it after the first 2 hours, and I thought, oh, maybe because the towel's still a bit damp, you know, it still needs to shrink. So then I put it in for another 2 hours and 15, whatever the cycle is. And then I measured it again, and it was still the same. And then the third time round, I measured it again. The towel was fully dry, and I just thought, well, this is it. I mean 6 hours in the dryer with a wet towel, if it hasn't shrunk by now, it, you know, I don't think it is going to shrink. So that's that. The fabric, by the way, I should just show you the fabric. It's 100% wool, and it's from the, I think it's called the Fabric Guys on eBay, and they sell quite a lot of lovely things on there. So 100% wool. It's in a burgundy color. And that's the wool there. So I don't know, with wool, I don't think there is a front and right side. And I think hopefully, I mean, I think you can do that interchangeably, as in I don't have to, it's not like with, So I think, you can choose either way. So it's just a lovely burgundy, it's not looking that nice in that light there, is it? A lovely burgundy wool there. I've got 3 meters of that, and I've got 3 meters still in my stash. And then the lining for that, I have some lovely Lady McElroy cotton lawn, which I bought for something else, actually. I think I've got 2 meters of this, or 2.5 meters. And I'll show it. I'll show you. It's the Coleman bouquet, I think it's called. So that's that there. And I thought it has that those bits of burgundy in the center of the flowers that would go quite nicely with the fabric here, with the wool here. So if I put it up together, I think that will look really nice, a really nice pop of color, but it still has the burgundy to tie it in together. And so now the two coat patterns that I'm after, or that I have, And I've got them already printed out in A0, are the, first of all, it's the Romana coat by By Hand London. It's this coat here. I've had this pattern for probably about 3 or 4 years as well. I bought it, I had the A0 printed out and I've never used it. I guess it was just quite intimidating for me. But what I like about this pattern is that it's a fitted coat. So it has, let me show you the seam lines. Okay. I'm using it now. Give it back afterwards. It is, I'll show you the seam lines. It's got princess seams at the front, princess seams at the back. It's got a vent, yay, with instructions, hopefully. It's got two-piece sleeves. It's got a collar, lapel, collar stand. And it's got, I think, I don't know if they are welt pockets. Are they welt pockets? Welt pockets. Flattering seams throughout and welt pockets. And apparently from reviews that I've read on this, there are a lot of tailoring skills that they show you in here. So is it called pad stitching the collar and sort of the sleeve heads and the welt pockets, and there are quite a few people that have made this, so their hashtag has got, I mean, I don't know, but a lot, I think like 100, I don't know, a lot on there that people have made this coat. So I can see what the other, you know, what other people have made and how it's turned out. And also there seems to be quite a lot of reviews and blog posts about it by people that have made it, which is really, really great. So just looking at one of the other blogs that I saw recently, there were some criticisms of the pattern. Apparently there's not enough notches when constructing the garment, especially for the welt pockets and the collar, and so it's a bit tricky to figure out, you know, how far you're supposed to stitch in, blah blah blah. And also the ease given for the coat is 2.5 inches, which isn't enough for a coat if you're going to wear clothes underneath. Now bear in mind the Tilly and the Buttons Lyra, for example, I know that's not supposed to be a fitted dress, but that for me is 2.5 inches of ease in the bust. So if that's a dress, I think a coat I would need to size up. And that's what that particular lady said on her vlog or blog, is that you would need to size up at least 2 sizes if you wanted to wear it with clothes underneath, basically, and be comfortable and have all that range of movement without feeling too stiff. So anyway, that's my first option. So this pattern goes from a size 6, which is a bust of 33, waist of 26, all the way up to a size 20, bust of 45, waist of 38 inches. Waist of 38 inches. And yeah, so that's one of my options. I mean, it's a fitted coat, as you can see. So it's fitted. You can either have one button or you can have a single breasted. You can also have a double breasted option with 4 buttons. So I quite like that. I like the shaping of it and everything. And I like the fact that lots of people have made it. So I've got lots of things to look at in terms of like if I need help, tips and tricks, that sort of thing. So that's my first option. The second option is the, I haven't got it printed out. I have the A0 printed out, but I don't have the instructions printed out, is the Vivienne coat by Sew Over. I'll pop up a photo. It's from their vintage e-dreaming, it's their vintage dreaming ebook. And it is a lovely, it's a vintage style. So it has, is it double breasted? I think it may be double breasted, but it's got the tie around the waist and it's got the collar and it's got the long sleeves and it's got the vent. It doesn't have princess seams, I don't think, but I'll have to double check. I'll pop up a photo. So this is another one. I mean, I like Sew Over It patterns because they are very feminine and they have got that vintage flair. So I do quite like this. Also, I like the fact that it's not fitted, and you can use the tie to cinch in the waist if you want to, or you can have it open if you please. But when I was looking up the hashtag, I think there's only like 5 people that have made it, maybe even, and then the rest of the photos on their hashtag are actually the models that they used for the actual pattern. So really the hashtag is only, I don't know, like 50 photos long. And so that kind of tells me that maybe not many people have made, well, obviously not many people, well, the people that have made it either haven't posted it or they haven't made it. And I know that Sarah from Super Bales, who is the model for Tilly and the Buttons, Lyra, funnily enough, has made it. And she is also a blogger for Jenny Stitches. And she is a sewing buddy of mine. We're not too close, but I mean, we talk to each other and stuff. So she's made it. And I have asked her a few questions about it as well. So she's made a fabulous one. And she seems to think that it was all right. So she's the only person that I know that's actually made it. And in terms of other examples of people wearing it, there's not that many, as I say, because on Instagram, there's not that many photos. So that's my second option. So I don't really know which one to go for. And that's my dilemma. So please do comment below which one you would like, which one you think would suit me better, or you think that I would deal with better, or you'd like to see more than the other. I'm thinking the Romana coat would be a bit more tricky than the Sew Over It coat. I mean, they have their pros and cons, so I'm not too sure. But those are the two options for my coat. So I'm just trying to figure out what to do first, or which one to go for. So what I'm planning to do is I'm going to try and do the Be Curious dresses. I've got three of those to do. And that will keep me busy for about a week, I would say. Because with the girls' dresses, I probably could churn one out in one evening or one and a half evenings. Or a day of sewing, like on a weekend or something. And then I will try and decide on what pattern to go for my coat. And then I should start cutting out all of that. So that's it, basically. Those are my plans for February 2024. What else do I have to say? No, that's it, really. Just another thing as well was, I don't know what everybody uses for cutting. So for cutting my fabric, I have done the scissors option before, which is great. I have done also the cutting mat and the roller. I don't know what anything's called. The rotary cutter, which is great as well. And then I also have electric scissors, which is great. So I find electric scissors aren't as accurate, but they're great for like cutting out sweatshirting or denim, that sort of thing. It's a nice quick, you know, movement. So I use it for that. For more precise things, I like to use my rotary cutter and my cutting mat. But I find that recently, I've got the Ulfa one, and I use the Ulfa blades. But I find that recently they've been getting, the blade has been getting quite dull, like after one cutting session, which is really annoying. So in the past, I have just been using the same blade, sort of, you know, just pushing harder and going, you know, using the same blade, you know, trying to prolong its life for as long as possible. And then when I recently changed it and I cut something out, it was literally no effort at all. Like I barely had to press it down and it just cuts like butter. And it was really, really cool. Amazing. Cool. And I thought, wow, that's the beauty of a new blade. So I thought, you know, I should change my blade more often. So I'm cutting away. And I think after about the second project, I was cutting. And they were like, it was cutting really, really nicely. But then there's like a dull point where it doesn't cut fully. So once I've cut through and I removed the fabric away, I still have to go back and cut all the little bits where it hasn't cut through. And that was really annoying me. And I'm thinking, I don't know why it does that. Or maybe it's my... Maybe it's like a groove in my where I cut through the cutting mat. Maybe it's like blunting the parts of the wheel. Anyhow, I have been buying the Ulfa blades, and I think they're like £10 for two blades or something like that. And so they are quite expensive. And I know that you can get a rotary blade sharpener, but then I think that's like £100 or something. So I don't even know if that's worth it. So anyhow, I decided to go for a different brand. And these are called Driffy Japanese steel. They also have them in titanium, which is more expensive, but I didn't get that. And you get 10 blades for like $9.99, which I know is really cheap, but I thought I'd just try it out anyway. And because if this one only lasts me one cutting session, then I might as well, and that's two for $9.99, I might as well get 10 and just try these out. So I don't know how these will fare. I'll let you know in my following vlogs if they're any good. So that's that one. And I also got some, what else did I get? I got some new snips. So I have the little stalk snips and overtops. They're the ones that I've had for years now. And every time I cut with them, I have to cut several times to actually cut, which is really annoying. And the girls that come to my sewing class on a Thursday, they have some really, really lovely snips. And when you cut, it cuts straight away. It's really, really nice and sharp. And so I thought I would buy some snips for myself, some new snips. So I thought I would buy these ones. I'm sure you've seen these around. They're non-branded ones. And I get three for, I don't know how much it was. I got three, the other one I've lost for like $9.99, just on Amazon. So I thought I'd give those a go. And then when I bought that, I realized that I had a pair of new snips in my stash somewhere. And it was this lovely Liberty pair that I bought for Christmas last year. And I don't know what this pair of scissors is called, but the girls from my sewing class have the exact same scissor. Does it have a brand or anything? I don't know what it's called. It says China. I don't think the brand is China. But these are super lovely and sharp, and it just comes in a little pouch wrapped in Liberty fabric. So I don't know why I told you that, but just stuff that I've bought sewing wise. And then I bought another pack of pins. These are my favorite pins because they're long. I like long pins, and they've got big heads so that they don't get lost. And I just use them. I know now, I've just realized actually, that they come in different thicknesses. So you have, for marking and ironing, what does that mean? Oh, for marking stuff, and I guess you can iron over them, but then they've got plastic heads. I don't know. Anyway, so these are the pins that I like to buy. So I got those from Amazon as well. I haven't bought any fabric. I actually got some money for Christmas to buy fabric, and I haven't actually bought anything. So that's great. So that's still in my in my account, I suppose, waiting for me to buy. But I don't really want to buy anything. I haven't found anything that I want to buy yet. So that's great. So I'm not going to buy anything for now. And that's it. That's my plans video all done and dusted. Thank you so much for watching. Please do like and subscribe. Please do share this with your sewing friends. And please do comment below on what coat you think I should make. In the meantime, thank you for watching. Take care of yourself. God bless. Bye-bye.